Welcome to the Second is for Everyone podcast. We welcome all people, regardless of race, gender, political party, sexual orientation, or background, to learn about your Second Amendment civil rights and the many facets of firearms ownership.
You suck. Hey, welcome. Episode 4 of the Second is for Everyone Shotcast. Shot Show Hangover is the
Shotcast.
Yeah, right. The Shotcast.
Shot out already. Wow. Oh
my goodness. Yep, so Shot Show is over. Lots of videos out. Been watching everything's going on. Seeing the new things that are coming out. And saw absolutely not many things to excite me. How about you, Sean?
Generally speaking, not a lot of earth-shattering new products out there. It seems to be there's a lot of stuff that's like, hey, here's the new version of something we've already done that we feel is an improved product and we want you to try and hopefully does well in the market. Reintroduce products, right? So I don't know if you want me to go into detail now, but we might save it for later. I don't know.
Yeah,
you want to do it now?
Now let's just talk about what's going on during the week. During our week.
Right.
We'll talk about the new stuff from SHOT during the Gear Horse segment. During the week, actually, I didn't do a lot besides the whole dry firing with the shirt pistol, the Glock 19 thing. I put some money down on a new pistol that we'll talk about when it gets in. So that's going to be my thing. I reached out on some social media and posted pictures of your rifle, the white rifle.
Mm-hmm.
You officially picked a name for it.
Project Arctic Wolf. The paw. It's so G.I. Joe.
G.I. Joe. So it's the paw. People have gone nuts. They were naming it, and I thought they were naming it a lot on Instagram or Facebook. They went bonkers on friggin' LinkedIn.
Yeah, LinkedIn was insane. I felt bad because you and I were talking about it, and I didn't get a chance to look at it until, as far as I was concerned, the naming contest was over, right? That was kind of a thing Matador and I threw together. We talked about it briefly last week. It was actually Annika from Matador's, it was her brainchild, and she decided to kick it off and sent me a message. Hey, if you don't like it, I'll delete it, but here's what I'm doing. And I was like, yeah, run with it. So we probably had a couple hundred responses between my Facebook and Instagram and her Facebook and Instagram. And I think you blew that out of the water just on LinkedIn.
Yeah, LinkedIn had over 250 names.
A lot of overlap, okay? Like, everybody came up with characters from Game of Thrones and Norse gods and stuff like that. There were some really interesting ones that popped up on yours that did not show up anywhere else. Like Stormtrooper stuff, R2-D2. Star Wars references were real big. They were kind of all over the place. But you had one guy gave me, like, the Inuit word for thundercloud or something. There was, you know, some guy called it a plastic AR-15. Another dude just decided to make fun of me. So I poked him back and I don't think he liked it, but, you know, understand everything is done with a sense of humor here. So please don't be upset. Along those same lines, I did have a very pleasant exchange on your page. For those of you listening who didn't realize, I'm also an admin on the 2A4E Facebook page with Dylan Nellens, and we kind of went back and forth a little bit, and he got it right away. Like, we were joking back and forth, so that was cool. And I saw you liked the way it ended because I told him I hated him.
Yeah, that was funny.
So that's just a quick shout out to Dylan. You're a cool kid.
I really appreciate everyone that answered, no matter where you were. I just thought it was pretty cool. They're starved for entertainment over LinkedIn. I just think they have to so be so businesslike that you kind of forget it's still social media.
Mm-hmm.
And they really jumped on it. And good luck with the person that won. I thought that was pretty cool. And Paul really sounds G.I. Joe-ish, but it is funny.
He knocked it out of the park. Like Arctic Wolf was cool to start with. And because I name everything, you know, Project Sabretooth, Project Counterpart, this is going to be Project whatever they came up with. And Project Arctic Wolf just kind of went, I was all over it. And he was one of the earliest respondents on, I want to say, on Matador's page. Yeah, but I saw that one. I was like, that's a good one. And I commented on it right away. That's a good one. And I went through all the others and I was like, yeah, nothing's jazzing me as much as that. So Matador sent out some stuff to him. He's actually in Canada. And I don't have his real name in front of me. I should have pulled that up earlier, but I've got a package going out to him on Monday. So a couple of little things for him just for being a good sport.
Yeah. Something else that happened. Let me see. It was him. Oh, you were right in your assertion about last week's show. Some people only read the title of the show and decided to correct me on my history of what came first, the 40 or the 10.
I'm like, disappointed in all our listeners because nobody dog piled on like I requested. I'm going to ask you guys to beat those people up and you have failed me. Worst.
I'm like, dude, just listen to the show. You'll get the reference. It's just the time. I'm sure that I'll probably, I mean, SHOT Show Hangover. I'm sure someone there will send me some information on how to quit drinking.
Yeah.
Or Alcoholics Anonymous or something with the name of this show. So it's just like, dude, listen to the, some guy.
What I don't know if you saw it, but, you know, sometimes, again, I for the most part, bite my tongue. And other times I go, yeah, you know what? I'm going to respond to this. And I just said, yeah, no, absolutely. How did you like the rest of the show? We're still waiting for a response to that comment.
It was great.
So,
yeah. But some guys so want to just teach the world.
Mm-hmm.
And give the world all of their knowledge. And it's like, yeah, brah, hey, you know, it would have been cool if you were to listen to the show.
Yeah, listen to it. We talk about it. We talk about it.
Well, so actually,
like, you go back a few episodes and you had one like, you don't need an AR-15 to hunt was the title of one of the episodes. And people got all bent out of shape about that. And I had to respond. Yeah. And I'm like, hey, it's just the title of the show. It's not our opinion. Try listening to the show. And one person did. Right. I can think of one in particular where he said, all right, I went back and listened to the show. You guys are awesome. I take back my earlier statement about wanting to rip your head off, you know, whatever it was. But he got it right. Like, we're not idiots, although the headline may suggest otherwise.
Yeah. Imagine that. A salacious headline. Right. In today's world, a salacious headline. But it was just really funny. It's like, come on, guys. One guy was telling me the same thing. Oh, so I was on another podcast. I was on Gun and Never Enough Ammo. He has a diversity podcast, and he just invites different people, and we talk about a lot of different things. And I brought up the information that I talked about on last week's show about most 10mm defensive ammo being loaded 240 Smith & Wesson ammo levels, ballistics. Oh, people lost it. Oh, 10mm for life, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, again, if you're using modern 10mm, yeah, 10mm ammo, it's not loaded any hotter than 40 Smith & Wesson defensive ammo outside of two loads
that they tested to it. Like, you just disrespected their set.
Yes, I am quite aware of that.
It's gang turf warfare now because you were talking trash about the 10mm.
It's 40 is short and weak version of 10.
About the 10mm life, bro. What you know about the 10mm life?
Do you even 10 millimeter, bro?
10 millimeter? You ain't never going to be 10 millimeter, so you better just keep your 9 millimeter behind up out of here.
Oh, it was so sad.
Sorry, I'm like, Smith & Wesson wannabe 10 millimeter mother...
Shut your mouth. I'm just talking about 10 millimeter.
Nailed
it. You're welcome. But it was just so juvenile. And I'm like, here's the link to the article. Read it. Oh, on the side of the box of Smith & Wesson. Hey, bro. SIG ammo 10 millimeter is loaded hotter than they didn't review SIG. These are the ones that they review. And again, having the ballistics on the side doesn't mean anything when you compare it to a gel test. Just because a 180 grain bullet does 1,000 feet per second in 40 Smith & Wesson and 1,300 feet per second in 10 millimeter still doesn't mean it penetrates deeper or expands more when tested in gel. It just doesn't. One is numbers.
And at this point, I feel it necessary to cue the lisping neckbeards who feel the need to point out ballistic gel tests are not the end-all be-all for ballistic science when it comes to pistol caliber ammunition.
It's a medium. It's a constant test medium. That's all. But, I love it. I'm like, why are you arguing with me? It's an article. Go argue with him. I didn't test anything. I just figured, Lucky Gunner doesn't have a dog in the fight because they will sell you ammo from anywhere.
Yeah.
So they tested ammo that they have on hand to actually increase the traffic to their blog and increase the traffic to their site.
Here's what we found. Now buy anything you want because we'll sell you all of it.
All of it. All of it.
Thanks for reading the article. Now give us your dollarses.
All the dollarses. So anyway, that's some of the stuff I got and some of the reaction I got over last week's show. I just thought it was funny. Thanks everybody to listen to it. I was trying to get a little bit of hype and I put a couple of different posters up or however you want to call them, flyers or whatever I do for the show. And it caught on a little bit and spread a little bit. But yeah. But I think maybe ballistics wasn't a thing, or maybe I did. Maybe I should just name it You Suck. And that should be the title.
Let's move on into this week's show, okay? Enough of
that. Yeah, the title of this week's show is You Suck.
You want to know more about last week's show? Listen to last week's show. This is this week's show.
I just found it funny. I thought it was interesting. Ballistics always gets some people going. All right.
Listen, people are going to get mad no matter what you do. Hey, here's a fun thing I did last night. I brought back the Black Bag Resources brain dump.
Yeah, I saw you did that. And
I dusted that off. Yeah, well, here's the thing. I've had people bugging me like, hey, Sean, we really missed that. We enjoyed that. It was a fun little thing to do on Friday nights for, 45 minutes or an hour. And we'd like you to start doing it again. And I guess because it's been a couple of months due to my work schedule and the holidays and yada, yada. People got really upset with me about the new haircuts because I guess that's the first time some of them have seen it and they're like, what is this? So,
that
was the hot news out of the brain dump. Everybody losing their mind over my haircut.
You're not as hot as you used to be.
Well, I figure more of me is covered. That should be an improvement.
That's the way I look at it.
Yeah.
Sure. You should do the brain. You should come back. It should look like an Al-Qaeda video when you do a brain dump.
Nice.
All right. Want to go? We're going to go away.
Podcast? No, I just turn off all the lights for the video.
Yeah.
Nobody wants to see this.
We're going to go away. Come back with legislation. All right.
Why? We were having fun.
We're still going to have fun.
Fine. Let's do legislation.
All right. See you in a minute. Welcome back. Episode 48, Shot Show Hangover. We're into legislation.
Legislation. Ryan Conrad is a gentleman who named Project Arctic Wolf. I just wanted to get that out there. I feel like he deserves it.
All right, so congrats.
You've got a little prize package coming from Matador, a little prize package coming from me. And if you're listening to the show, thanks.
All right.
Now you can do the things you want to do.
Yeah, thanks. I really appreciate that. You couldn't even wait for me to finish, like, introducing him.
No.
So congratulations. You gave him a little G.I. Joe name for his little project. And he's all happy. Like, Snow Leopard wasn't good enough. So Arctic Wolf it is, Paul.
Because Snow Leopard was not good enough.
Whatever. Well, yeah, you had to have a Canadian name it for you, so I'll leave it at that.
Yep. Hey, who knows better about snow stuff than Canadians?
Yeah, sure. we're going to talk about
legislation.
I'll just go ahead and throw this out there. You need to contact your legislators to oppose the silly universal background check bill, which is H.R. 8. That's in the House, and S-42, that's in the Senate. Contact them. You can go through your NRA ILA app or NRA ILA page and send them emails that way. You can also get the information, whom to call, get their phone numbers and their mailing addresses so you can actually send something to them. Also, something you should oppose is, of course, Dianne Feinstein's new 2019/old assault weapons ban. S-76, which is ridiculous. And
assault weapons bans are like the horror movie, like slasher flick villain of firearms legislation. Like, they die, they come back, they get killed again, they come back. So here we are with Dianne Feinstein's assault weapons ban part 17. Assault weapons ban goes to New York. Like, it's so stupid.
This is how stupid it is. They have a part of the new assault weapons ban that says this. It's illegal to make something that works its way around the assault weapons ban. It's illegal to come up with a legal product, because they don't want innovation. So it's illegal to comply with the law. It's illegal to build a part that complies with the law as it is written. That's illegal.
Right. You have to comply with the spirit of the law. Well, Dianne, I'd like you to comply with the spirit of a little thing called the Second Amendment to the Constitution.
Yeah.
How about that?
That'd be great.
Every gun law is an infringement, you monster.
I mean, I don't understand why she has such a hard time understanding the Second Amendment and the Bill of Rights since she was a teenager when it was signed. I don't understand it. She was there. But yeah, it's like, okay, so you came up with these stupid rules, and if anyone invents anything like maybe a thumbhole stock to get rid of past some of your feature stuff, right. Oh, that's illegal. If I have a featureless,
here's the bottom line. Rifle. She wants everything banned. She wants no private ownership of firearms, period. She does not want you having a flintlock musket. She doesn't want you being able to fight anyone ever for any reason at all. That is the bottom line. Her legislation is just nibbling towards that goal. That's all it is. And if it sounds like a big bite to us, I promise you it's still a nibble in her mind, because until she has everything completely banned so that private firearms ownership is no longer a thing in the United States anywhere, she's unsatisfied.
I have to add a word. I'm sorry. Legal firearms ownership. Because again, right. None of this does anything to criminal enterprise except makes us more victims of anything anyone who's armed wants to do to you, or anyone that outnumbers you or is stronger than you or is your government wants to do to you can be done to you when as a whole society is disarmed. That's all. There's no fear of you rising up and doing anything if I can just squash you down.
And to be fair, Tony, your statement earlier that she was there when all of that was written and signed. obviously she was alive at that time, but she was not present. She was busy like pillaging Carpathia and bathing in the blood of virgins or something.
Yeah. She's been around a while, but it's the same old, believe me. Because a lot of people going, you know, oh, if we could just get rid of that woman, she's not alone. If she was just the crazy old lady in the corner coming up with anti-gun bills that no one paid attention to,
if it was just her and her 65 cats, she wouldn't be doing any damage. She gets a bunch of stupid people to agree with her. That's the problem.
Uh-huh. And there's new generations to take her place. So please don't make voodoo dolls of this witch.
Yeah, I apologize.
And try to do bad things to it.
I shouldn't call those people stupid. They are misguided, but they're not stupid.
I don't think they're misguided. I think they're freaking evil. But I want to talk about some good news. Okay. Indiana has a new bill proposed that's going in front of the State House Committee, Bill 1284, which enhances protections offered to law-abiding citizens acting in defense of themselves. Yeah, that's right. This bill, a trial court. Oh, I'll go ahead and read it because really, if I don't, it's going to sound bad. It will provide immunity for justified use of force in certain instances. A trial court would be required to conduct a pretrial hearing concerning the application of the immunity when the defendant raises the justified use of force immunity as a defense and dismiss the claim when justified force is used. The bill would also require court to award in certain instances reasonable attorney's fees if it determines a suit was brought unjustly, helping to prevent financial ruins for individuals protecting themselves and others.
That's the part that I think is really important, because anytime you hear about these cases where specifically a home was broken into, right? And I don't know there's too many states in the country that have laws prohibiting you from defending yourself inside your home. Outside your home, we get into duty to retreat versus stand your ground. But inside your home, it's usually castle doctrine, even in very restrictive states like New Jersey. So in those states, it can be problematic in that the family of the criminal who broke into your home with the intention of murdering you is now painted as a victim of an overzealous gun owner who happened to be at home when this poor misguided youth who is stealing from you so he could buy books for school. Nonsense. They were there with bad intentions and they got what they deserved. Unfortunately, death was a part of that. But their actions had to be stopped for the safety of the person in the home. So unfortunate byproduct was they died because of it. I don't feel the person who was protecting themselves was in the wrong. With that said, these people have families who invariably sue the homeowner who was the victim of this crime because they love their poor little misguided perpetrator. So the fact that this legislation could potentially put an end to that in a way that would resolve it with restitution and not leading to the financial ruin of the victim of the crime, I think is finally a step in the right direction for justice.
I don't understand. Larry the Assassin Johnson was just stopping by your house to collect for church in the middle of the night with a crowbar, a ski mask, and a gun with the grip taped up so, you know, he could easily take it off for his fingerprint.
Right, serial number filed off and all that stuff. But he's just a poor misunderstood young boy at the age of 33.
Who just got out of jail and was still awaiting trial. And was still awaiting trial for something else. Yeah. It's really good. But this is also one of those things. This comes in that self-defense insurance kind of thing. Mm-hmm. This is what that does, but it's kind of important that you have that too. So
fact that it has legislative backing, I think is the biggest part. And I would love to see, as much as we're seeing the extreme risk protection order laws spread like wildfire, maybe this could be the other side of that. Well, guess what? Yeah, you might get away with passing your stupid extreme risk protection order that really does nothing but disarm people who have committed no crime. But on the other side of the coin, maybe we can get this passed in more places that, yeah, special trial to prove that it was self-defense before we proceed with anything else. And if it was self-defense, the whole thing gets dismissed and the attorney's fees can be recouped by the victim who was forced into a trial proceeding that shouldn't have been.
And I thought that was some good news. I'm going to try to start throwing good news legislation in also, or positive firearms legislation, just because it depresses me so.
Dude. It's hard to find, though.
I'm not saying I'm doing it every week. I'm just saying if I can find it, I'm going to put it in because it's depressing just to feel your rights are always under attack and there is no positive. Well, there is. And if you live in these states, support it. Just because it's happening doesn't mean you shouldn't write those people and go, hey, thank you very much. I really believe in this, and I appreciate your effort. That's cool. I'm a law-abiding citizen. I think you're doing the right thing. Yay. All right. So that's legislation. I feel that we went through that, and I feel a little more positive now.
Lucy. Let's wrap it up, break it off, and move on to something more fun.
Oh, look at you. Want to just do stuff quickly now. All right. We'll be back. Mad minute.
I'm in the groove, baby.
Yeah.
I'd like to take a minute to talk about High Point Firearms. I purchased my own High Point 40 cal Smith & Wesson pistol and wrote a review about it on the firearmsinsider.tv. I stand behind every positive word I said in that review. High Point has supported the diversity shoot with swag, hats, t-shirts, and in the last year, carbines. They're an American company with a lifetime warranty on their products and a price that can't be beat. If you want a range gun, a truck gun, or an inexpensive self-defense firearm, you should look into High Point pistols and carbines.
Welcome back. Episode 4, SHOT Show Hangover. We're in the Mad Minute. Mad Minute this week is, yet again, while posting about Anthony Colandro being the tip of the spear of the 2A movement in New Jersey, I get in the NRA page, of course, somebody goes, well, New Jersey's lost anyway. You're wasting your time. You need to leave and move. And the tip of the spear is, it's got a rubber tip. You're not doing any good there. So, of course, I'm a human being. I'm a human being, and Anthony Colandro's a friend. A sponsor. He allows this actual diversity shoots to take place at Gun for Hire range. And I was about to, I was trying to figure out how to say something constructive to this guy because the internet's full of negative. So this is what I said. I'd rather stay here and fight for my own rights. That's what I do as long as I can. And I know Anthony Colandro is here with me because I see the work he does and I'm beside him when he does a lot of it. I have no idea what you do for our Second Amendment rights, but I think I'll stick by the people that I know are doing work. And for some reason, for the last 2 days, this guy has had no response. I hear this a lot.
You notice that you and I end up killing a lot of threads.
I didn't say you don't do anything. No. I know what he does. I don't know what you do. And of course, you know, there's no long list of things that any of these people who say, just move. Have you ever moved? I wonder if these people have ever packed up all their crap and moved to another state. To just throw it out there as like a piece of advice. Just move. Or do they not pay attention to the legislation all over the country? Coming to every state, that's the exact same crap that's here in Jersey. So,
I mean, it must be nice to live that nomadic life where as soon as somebody does something you don't like, you can just turn tail and run. You don't have any roots. You don't have a job to worry about. You don't have a family with friends or, you know, kids in school to think about that. You can just go, forget it. I'm out of here.
Yep. That legislation passed. Oh, I'm packing all of my stuff and I'm moving.
Toodles. Bye-bye.
Yeah. Nope. My wife's got to go. Family connections. All that. I should just sever all of that because of legislation that I could fight.
Yeah, nah. Which is weird because, like, the whole NRA thing is stand and fight. And then you hear all these NRA members go, no, just run. Just turn tail and run.
Well, it's also the same ones, cold, dead hands, vote from the rooftop. Excuse me. Mm-hmm. Cold, dead hands, vote from the rooftop, run.
Sorry. I'm allergic to that nonsense.
I find it ridiculous, and I'm not going to say it's cowardly, but you don't win fights by running from fights. And legislation follows you everywhere. What happens when states like New Jersey fight and we win, and we do have some wins, is that it gives pause to the other states that want to shove that same legislation down because they all pay attention to what's happening in other states. The anti-gun politicians are all the same people on the same payroll. So when something is tried here and it gets shut down, they might not try it somewhere else, so they hold off, or they go in to try it in Nevada, they try it in Oregon, and if it gets shut down there too, all right, back to the drawing board. We'll try to slide that one in next year. This fight never ends, and moving or running away won't help. They're doing this in every state. They're doing it in Texas. They're definitely doing it in California. Mm-hmm. New York has a whole nother set of SAFE Act stuff that they're trying to push through now. Whole new list of dumb stuff. Actually, it starts next week in New York. So you want to pay attention to that. It starts up Monday. It's ridiculousness. And you have to fight it on every level. And running is not the answer. So if you live in a free state and you really want to help someone in a state like Jersey, donate to our state chapters of the NRA, like the ANJRPC. Donate to the CNJFO. Donate to the Second is for Everyone. You can help us many different ways if you live in a free state and you have somehow no problems. Or maybe you should join one of your state groups and find out that, yeah, you do have some attacks going on in your own capital. And you need to defend against those. You have to become educated. Running away is not an option because there's nowhere to run anymore. You're going to have to fight. You're going to have to do that whole freedom thing that we all talk about. This is the time. If you're a grown man and you're not on the list by now, because please don't use that as your excuse, that you've done nothing and you need to do something. You need to fight for your rights. You need to, if you're not going to rally, you need to write some letters. You need to make some phone calls. You need to join a group, or you can send money to a group, or you can support a group. Heck, how's this? You don't want to have anything to do with anything. You don't want any paper trail. Then donate to the Second is for Everyone by buying something for Black Bag Resources and using the code 2A4E. And at least the gifts and swag stuff can be given out. And you help that way. And it just looks like you made a purchase from Black Bag Resources. No one knows what happened. There are ways you can help. Do it. Everybody can do something. That's all I'm saying.
Yep.
Wow. That mad minute got kind of rambly.
I like how you turned it into a commercial at the end.
Yeah, it's frustrating. Because there's a lot that you can do that doesn't involve a flag, a Gaston flag, and open carrying at a rally.
Right, right. And maybe that's not your thing, right? Maybe your schedule doesn't permit that. Maybe it's easier for you to make a donation to an organization. That's fine, right? I'm never going to bash that. But you know, just make sure you're doing as much as you possibly can. That's what I will ask of you.
Yeah, do what you can. And stop giving horrible advice. Run, run, Forrest, run. It's not how you win fights. It's not how you win this fight. All right, that was a mad minute. We did the dance. Now we're going to come back with Gear Whore.
Oh boy, oh boy.
Yeah, kind of cool. Welcome, episode SHOT Show Hangover. This is the Second is for Everyone podcast, and we're talking Gear Whore. talking about some of the stuff that was at SHOT Show this year, I thought it was a lot of stuff. I think a lot of manufacturers started introducing things before SHOT Show. So there wasn't a bunch of things that were like brand new. Oh my God, clutch my pearls. You know what I mean? Because Glock came out with their 43X and Glock 48 before the show. So it was already released. They have them in the stores. I got to handle the Glock 48. It's a pretty much a single stack Glock 19. That's what people used to ask for. That's what the PD-10 is. Rob Pincus was trying to put out.
I feel like that's what people asked for back in the 80s when Glock first released the double stack 17 and 19. But I kind of look at it now and I go, I don't understand. Like, the whole point of buying a Glock for the last 30 years has been, bro, you need more capacity. That's why you downgrade from the 45 to a 9mm. Then you get 17 rounds in the magazine, bro. And then the same dude is like, oh, yeah, why do you need 17 rounds? Can't you shoot worth anything? You know, the single stack is more concealable, but this 10-round capacity is awesome. Why? Why are we going backwards?
Well, I think they're right. It is easier to conceal the thin gun. Striker fired, single stack, 9mm. It's a good idea. Concealed carry's going up multiple states. There's millions of concealed carriers, way more than there was in the 80s and the 90s. So it's a thing. People aren't willing to dress around the gun. They're going to have their gun go into the outfits that they wear. So yeah, a thin gun makes sense. Other companies have been doing it. Congratulations, Glock, for realizing that that's what people want and finally coming around to it. What's annoying is the number of people that act as if it was something like ground. Oh my goodness, Glock came up with what other people have been doing for 20 years. Car Arms' entire basis was on a single stack concealed carry pistol.
Ruger's LC9, right? What's the other one? Their security, like,
it's been done. It's been done to death. Glock finally got around to doing it. So now all of a sudden, the people that take their marching orders from Glock and get paychecks from Glock and get money from Glock.
And that's really what I'm saying, is it's the Glock fanboys that I don't understand. The fanboys who told us we needed double stack for the last 30 years are now saying how great and innovative it is to have a single stack that everyone else has always done forever and ever.
Well, it's the magazines and the social media guys that get paid to say this, and they do it. These guys aren't independent. They're the same squawkers that squawk and tell you what the industry needs. Meanwhile, certain guns don't get bought. Right. These guys says grace. Glock did their thing.
Put peanut butter and jelly together. Good job. What's next?
I saw Kel-Tec came out with a single stack KSG. Kel-Tec has a KS7, which is now a 7-shot bullpup shotgun that only has one cylinder under it and one barrel, of course. So now they came out with that, and it weighs 7 pounds. I'm like, okay. And it's short. And it's totally untested. It's brandy new. So no, I'll stick to the 870 I have.
It's got to work better than the KSG, though.
It should work better in theory than the KSG.
Yeah.
What else came out? Our friend Kevin Dixie has a new handgun that came out. That was pretty cool. He has his own series of special handguns. Him and Terrell Defense, I think that's the name of the company. They came up with his own gun. I said pricing will be named later. He gave kind of a hint. It's really expensive, custom everything on a VP9.
He put it out this morning or yesterday evening?
No, 2 days ago.
2 days ago, but yeah, what I saw, is this right? 19 and change?
Yep.
Yeah.
$1,900 for a pretty much totally customized pistol with everything done to it. All kinds of cuts, all kinds of lightning cuts, Cerakote, stippling on not only one set, but all of the back grips or whatever that you can put on the VP9, including the side plates. And a pretty cool case that talks about one of my favorite things, and is victimization of unarmed blacks in history. His thing is Black Wall Street, and almost 200 people killed during that incident, with the help of the government of Oklahoma and normal citizens again. And it's just the truth. I think that might be even what the pistol's called, the truth. So that's pretty cool. But yeah, it's a $1,900 price point, but it's a total customized pistol.
Well, I'm torn on it, right? Because I'm not spending that much on a handgun. Not my
But
I did see Kevin responded to somebody who was like, oh, it should only be X amount of dollars. And Kevin was like, no, break all this down, do the math, add it up. Because he includes the light, he includes the red dot. It's got everything.
It's got everything.
And I'm looking at it going, that's not a bad package deal, right? Like, if you bought all that stuff separately and you were sending it out to have that work done, it probably cost you $2,500. So,
and also understand what the money's also going to, which is aiming for the truth.
Right.
Aiming for the truth. This is charity. So it goes to something else, not the whole one gun, one gunsmith thing. And, you know, the company's just soaking up a large percentage of it just based on their name.
Right.
This is actually going to a cause that helps a lot of other people. But so I thought,
I just wanted to respond with like hashtag stop being poor.
Stop being poor. And their idea of, oh, a good price is $1,200. Good, that $1,200 is a lot of stock guns out there now that are high end or, you know, nicely done. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Some guns with trigger work, like the new Walther Q5 steel, that's like $1,200 with everything. And it's a race gun. It's a steel race gun by Walther, steel framed. Walther PPQ trigger, all of that, and that's around $1,200. I thought that was cool, but it's only a cool for a race gun. I mean, it's heavy as heck. It's almost 40 ounces, so it's not really a carry gun when you have the PPQ match, you know what I mean, that you can actually carry, and it's polymer, and it weighs like 27 ounces or something like that. But yeah, Walther came out with that. I thought it was nice. I'm not Google Gaga over it, but I thought it was nice. And just various things came out. Nothing just caught me. Like Daniel Defense came out with a bolt action rifle. Yeah, okay. I'm like,
I hate them.
That's cool. I guess you call it diversifying. Oh, and they say it's an entry level rifle for Daniel Defense. So it's like, you know, $1,200 to $1,500. No, thank you. Peace. I was just looking at the stuff. Like, I'm not impressed by any of the new things that came out. I'm not blown away by it. Colt came out with their King Cobra and 357 Magnum.
Next.
Okay. Yeah. It's like, eh. FN came out with their FN 509 medium frame, which is the same size as the Glock 19.
Okay.
Yeah. It's cool.
And this is what I'm talking about. It's like variations of other things they've already done, and they're hoping that, all right, well, you know, we've gotten some feedback and we've made some adjustments based on what customers tell us. So there you go.
Yeah, and it's not like I'm poo-pooing your favorite maker. It's just I'm like, oh, okay.
Let's be honest, Tony, part of the problem is us, and we've seen these trends before, right? We've seen the ups and downs. So it's a little bit harder to get us excited about things.
You can't come up with something. We have an orange now. Ooh. You heard me, right? It's orange. It's freaking orange. Yeah, I heard you. Stop yelling.
No, look, just Timber Creek did. But this year at SHOT Show, they announced they're doing an emerald green set of furniture. I love green. I think it's great that they're doing a different version of green other than like olive drab. You know, I go, okay, all right, I'm in. I got to see if I can squeeze another rifle build in time for St. Patrick's Day. But
Magpul has furniture for the CZ Scorpion. Okay.
Mm-hmm. And magazines.
Yeah, we got magazines. Okay. But here's the thing. The Scorpion magazines weren't expensive anyway.
They weren't terrible, no.
No, I mean, it's like, okay.
And they work really well. I've never heard anybody complaining about the Scorpion magazines. There was something else early on that they were complaining about, but I don't think it was mags.
Oh, I found it funny that DSA, who usually makes, what do you call those? HKs. They make HK copies. They coming out with Israeli FAL rifles now. They picked up kits for old school Israeli FALs, add the receivers, threw barrels on, and they're selling that for ridiculous prices. Like, now, yeah. it would be cheaper for me to build a time machine and go back to the late 80s and buy one than it would be to buy one of these. So now, just now.
Since you're going to break out the time machine, can we use that to go pick up AES-10Bs? Because I see that Century is re-releasing those for three times what they cost the last time around.
Yeah.
The AES-10B is an RPK variant. So think AK on steroids. This is like the squad automatic version of an AK. So heavier receiver, reinforced trunnion, longer barrel, bipod. You know, just bigger, beefier AK. Still uses 7.62x39 for those of you that aren't familiar. And I love mine, right? I have one of the Century guns, and I don't remember the model number, but it was the one that came out after the AES-10B when those ran out last time, right? But The 10Bs were going for like $500, and I got mine for $650. And they're like, yeah, you know, it's American made. It's a little bit better. I've had no problems with it. It runs great, but it doesn't have the carry handle like the 10B has. Well, now they're re-releasing the 10B, and the price they were quoting at SHOT Show is $1,500.
There you go.
$1,500.
Grab two at that price. I mean, if you want one,
at that price, I'm thinking I'm going to start shopping for an RPD instead of an RPK. Right? I want to get into a belt fed. Forget it. Like, if I'm going to spend that much, it's just another $1,000 to get into the belt fed.
Belt fed is life. Belt fed is life. But
and the same thing with their PSL. They're talking about re-releasing the Romanian PSL. That's $2,500 to $2,600. Going, those things were $800 the last time they were available.
Again, either people going to buy them or people aren't. If you don't, they sell out. They come off the market, and then they come out again in 10 years. They're going to be more money. It's just that simple. Is it worth it? It gets to the point that I'm saying, no, it's not. I mean,
no. Yeah, I was I posted it on Facebook a couple of times. Like, this is the only thing I've seen at SHOT Show that really has my mouth watering. And then as soon as the price tag started coming out, I was like, nope.
Mouth dried right up.
Dried right up.
Yep. Anybody got water? It's dry in here. I'm parched.
That looked like the Tom and Jerry cartoon. Like,
just suck those cheeks right in.
Yep.
Oh, it's funny because Kimber came out with some new stuff that I don't care about at all.
Okay, so we don't even need to talk about it then?
Uh-huh. Next. Now, I saw something that's a Glock pistol brace from New Flux Defense. Have you seen that?
I'll tell you what, this is something we may disagree on. I think this is kind of cool.
Oh, I think it's kind of cool too. It's a pistol brace that goes onto the back of your Glock handgun. And when you pull it out, you hit the button. It's pretty much the button itself that releases the pistol brace. It extends. It's an extending spring-loaded pistol brace that pops right out, that you use to brace on your cheek or your forearm. Or you just shove in your shoulder like a little tiny SBR, but it goes on the back of your Glock, and it is a shoulder brace. I mean, a pistol brace.
It's a pistol brace. Yep.
And it fits right into your holster, and you could cover it up with a jacket or something. But it's a pistol brace for your handgun.
It's a pistol brace for your Glock, right? And they're talking about coming out with different variants for other handguns. It's also limited as to which size and which generation you can use it on right now.
Mm-hmm.
But I believe they have them in black and flat dark earth. To me, it looks pretty cool. It deploys pretty quickly. They did think it through to the point where they went, okay, if you know, we still want you to be able to carry this. So here's a holster that works with this product. They also have a holster out. So they've kind of gone 360 as far as all that goes. I don't know if their holster accommodates a light mount or not. I got to do a little more research on it. But just from a thumbing your nose at the government standpoint and saying, here's a product that works around your bogus laws that make no sense. I'm happy Flex Defense has come up with this. And from what I've seen, it looks like it works really well. They've got a couple of tutorial videos out where they're saying, you know, your instinct may be to press this button and then leave your finger there, take your finger off of that, tap it, make sure it's locked in place, and then utilize it. But like, it looks like it works really well. It looks pretty slick. It doesn't turn me off in any way that certain other products do, right? Where you look at it and you go, all right, cool idea, but ugh.
Honest Outlaw has a video out. He's using it. It comes with two different springs, so you can increase the spring tension to help pop that sucker out. I think it's worth looking at. And Tim from Military Arms Channel, he has one that he actually purchased because it shut down a bunch of internet haters that talked about people getting free stuff on the internet, you know, the YouTuber guys. And he was like, nah, I bought mine. And Flux Defense actually sent a text. Yeah, hey, thanks, Tim, for buying yours and not asking for it like a lot of these social media guys do for free. So I thought that was cool.
Give Tim credit there. He turns me off with a lot of his other stuff, and I'm kind of punched out from following him. Mm-hmm. But he will go so far as to say, look, I bought this, and here's a picture of the item with the receipt.
Yep.
Right? So just shut up about that part of the argument.
I think that's about it. I mean, we've been going on for a while of what's in shot. And I got a couple
more things that I was interested in. Yeah.
Yeah, well, you know what? Let's roll back with it.
You want to do round two?
Yeah, let's do a round two with it. We'll be right back with more Gear Horror. Welcome back. Gear Horror Part 2, Episode 48, SHOT Show Hangover. What's up, Sean? What are you excited about?
Partly because I'm an Odinworks dealer, and partly because they've done really well by me as far as the quality of their products. I use their barrels. I use their safety is on, you know, Project Arctic Wolf. And I've done really well with a lot of their stuff. And you're also on the Gun and Gear Review podcast. Chad Wallace from that show did a review of one of their muzzle brakes. He had nothing but high marks for it. So they make a bunch of good stuff, but they released a bunch of new products at SHOT this year that they didn't even hint at prior to that. So that was kind of interesting. Some stuff I kind of question, right? They have an adjustable buffer for AR series firearms, whether it's a pistol, rifle, 9mm, 5.56, whatever. And basically you can unscrew the face of it and change the weights out. That's one of those things where I look at it and go, okay, good idea, because now I can just buy that and I don't have to worry about what it's going into because I can customize it. And then part of me goes, but I can just buy the right buffer for what I'm building. So price point, I didn't get my hands on the price point yet. That will determine whether or not this is a good idea. If it's even close to what a regular buffer costs, I think that's going to be the smart way to go, because then whatever build you're getting, you just stock those. And from a dealer standpoint, I can just tell customers, look, this is a dollar more than the other one, but I guarantee it'll work with whatever you want because you can adjust the weights on it. Very simple. They also released both a brace and a stock. And this is the one trend I'm kind of noticing this year is these things have to be spring loaded, right? Because their stock and their brace are both collapsible and they're both spring loaded, just like the Flex Defense pistol brace we were just talking about. So reasonable price point, again, comparatively across the market, I think they're $250 or $260, something like that, for a PDW style stock assembly, right? It's the entire kit. It's not just a stock you're dropping on that would only be $50 or $60. You know, when you're talking about a complete assembly like that, like I have the Troy Tomahawk, that was a little bit more initially. They came down to about that price point now, but they were three and change originally and not spring loaded.
Yeah.
So same kind of thing there. And they're doing, and it they look very similar. But if you like that style of collapsible brace, you'll be able to put it on your AR pistol. And then you can have a matching stock to go with your rifle if you're building a set or whatever. What else? Something else you wanted to jump in with?
Yeah, well, Brownells, of course, with their retro line, it's awesome.
Mm-hmm.
I really love that. They came out with 605, which is their dissipator that looks like the AR M16 605 variant that they had back in the day when they were trying to figure out how to shorten ARs with their gas system and everything. They also came out with the BRN10 waffle magazines for the AR-10, their version of the AR-10, so it looks like the old school waffle mags. I thought that was pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
For crazy shout out kind of stuff, there's a company that came out with, it's called the S333 Volley Fire, 8-shot double barreled snub nose 22 magnum revolver. How crazy is that? It looks like it looks like a revolver with an Arctic trigger on it, which is like just an extended trigger that you would be able to shoot with like a mitten on. That's what they do on some of the old school Arctic rifles.
Mm-hmm.
So of course I'm like, what kind of idiotic crap is this? Well, Ian and Carl from N-Range TV actually checked it out and went, it's built well. The trigger, when you pull it like they want you to pull it, is really easy to pull. They were like, when you have someone who's older or has weak hand strength, this really works out well. And it's two rounds of 22 Magnum in a revolver. Not horrible. Not what they thought it was. Because I thought it was just another piece of garbage. I'd like to see one, but I doubt if anybody will ever order something like that. I mean, 8 rounds of 22 Magnum.
The double barrel stuff just seems like a gimmick to me, right? Mm-hmm. Like, we had the double 1911, the double AR, the double shotgun, and the DP12, and now we've got the double 22 revolver. And I just go, I talked about this on the brain dump last night. Like, there's so many things that can go wrong there that to me outweigh the things that go right. I don't get it.
Watching them, listening to them talk about it, as knowing these aren't the people that, you know, get that paid sponsorship, and mm-hmm. they look at things with a critical eye, and if it sucks, it sucks, to the point that they're banned from the Franklin Armory booth because they crapped all over the Reformation. And actually caught Franklin Armory saying two different things, talking out of both sides of their face. I'd listen to them more. You can check out the video on N-Range TV on YouTube. But something else they had was a Tippmann Armory 9mm Gatling gun. Dude, talk about just a cool, if you got a couple thousand dollars to throw away, it's a Gatling gun that takes Glock mags. And it just rotates. It's done like a Gatling gun back in the day with how it operates, but it's not all that gold and brass trimmed out kind of thing. And it's just mm-hmm. a cool range toy up on wheels that rotates, and it takes.
I didn't see that.
Yeah, dude.
So is the Glock mag like fed in the top upside down? Boom. Like the old?
Yeah, kind of, sort of. I think you stick the Glock mag in the top or the side, little side. It fires from the 4 o'clock position. So whatever, you know, the barrel is at the 4 o'clock position is the one behind the firing pin when you rotate okay. it. But it fires one barrel at a time, of course, just like a Gatling gun, but it just feeds from a Glock mag. And it's a fun gun. I mean, because regular Gatling guns, if you buy one with the Colt, what's tens of thousands of dollars at this point, I think it's like $28,000 or something. Mm-hmm. It's crazy. This is like in the category of, well, you can buy a belt fed or one of these. Actually, it's not even belt fed money, because I think the belt feds from FN, the semi-autos, are like, what, $8,000?
Yeah, if you're talking about the 249 semi-auto.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that's like an $8,000.
Yeah, I mean, this
what's,
is...
What's the Fight Light upper go for? I think that's like $4,500, something like that.
Yeah, something, I guess. I just look at it as expensive, fun range toys, not anything else you're going to do with it. I mean, yeah, okay, you got a 9mm Gatling gun.
I think RPDs are still just under $3,000. That's a belt fed, but yeah. Hey, 9mm Gatling gun sounds like a good time.
One, it's cheap to feed, it's fun. But that's all I
all of a sudden it sounds like one of your old YouTube reviews. And I like it.
And I like
it's fun. And I like it because it's fun. And it's fun because I like it.
Why would
it's like
you
bad Dr. Seuss.
Why would you ever let me do that? And the sad part is not the worst YouTube reviews out there, but yeah, my
no, no, no. The early ones were pretty raw, as they say. Yeah. The only other thing I thought was interesting was Odinworks jumped into the silencer game, and they put out four different models of suppressors that are, I believe 5.56 and 30 caliber. And depending, so they've got four different models, direct thread on the 5.56 and 30 caliber, and then one with a muzzle device in 5.56 and 30 caliber. And they range from like 500 to 650. So not terribly expensive as far as that goes, but we didn't get any other real data on them as far as like how much they reduce sound, stuff like that. And then the only other thing I saw that kind of jazzed me in the suppressor world was OSS, mm-hmm. that uses that weird like spinning vortex method of reducing the gas pressure and sound. They released a can for the 338 Lapua that is significantly smaller than anything else that was on the market currently.
Yeah. I was going through everything. I've been going through different manufacturers. Now, we saw it before. I thought they'd already released it, but High Point has threaded carbines, 9mm carbines now. I thought they'd released that last year. But I guess they're out now, and they also have Canadian versions of the carbines. So they have like 19-inch barrels, and they've had to cut the pistol grip down so it actually takes C9 magazines instead of its own carbine magazine. And they have a mm-hmm. California legal version that's featureless. Of course, it just has a Kydex little shark fin on the back of the pistol grip, so you can't wrap your thumb right around a pistol grip, making it California legal. And then there's the new, I call it John Wick trailer trash, C9.
the product Tony Simon is most excited about coming from SHOT Show.
Yeah.
The new High Point pistol.
The new High Point C9. That'll be the Tony Simon signature edition. It has front serrations. It has rear serrations. They've changed the design. They changed the High Point logo that's on the side of the gun. They also have a grip safety while still having a thumb safety, and it has a double stack 10-round magazine in the new C9. It's not out yet. They're checking it out. I guess they're working their way through it, and it has a regular accessory rail instead of that High Point specific accessory rail. So that's
and a threaded barrel.
And it has a threaded barrel, and it also has a rear sight that you can take out and replace with a pick rail that you can put an optic on. So what's really funny is somebody made a joke, but it said it's sad that High Point was way more innovative this year's SHOT Show than Glock was. Wow. An optic ready threaded High Point pistol with front serrations and a double stack magazine. Oh yeah, I was actually talking to them and I was like, oh, okay, why the grip safety?
That's a good burn.
That was a good burn. But yep, they got the grip safety on it. They were, so maybe they changed that up a little bit.
You asked them why the grip safety.
What I asked was their them why answer? The grip safety. You said the grip safety cuts down on the rattling inside of the pistol. Truthfully, look, when I carry my High Point pistol, I don't use the safety. The trigger pull is stiff enough that it's not needed. Also, the way it's on there, it's really difficult to sweep off. And I've said that in my review. So for someone like me that won't use it because really it's horrible in the way it's on, it makes it difficult. At least I can't get to it quickly and consistently, and that's a problem. This grip safety kind of makes it safer. But the gun's not even out. They made that one. They put it out. They're probably going to get feelers out and see what they're going to do. But I thought it was pretty cool that a company that wouldn't have a double stack now has a 10 round double stack 9mm pistol.
Now listen, as much as people will make fun of the appearance of the gun, I think the new logo looks pretty good.
Yeah, it does. New logo looks pretty cool.
New logo looks pretty cool. Some people, you get the High Point haters who hate anything High Point does, so they can do no right. But at the same time, I go, it's a much cleaner look than the older style, right? It's still kind of big and chunky, but they're obviously
How's this? For the price of a threaded barrel, you can buy an entire pistol that's threaded.
Mm-hmm.
You're not, let's be truthful, you're not running around in Assassin's Creed or anything else or Hitman with your gun. So more than likely, that's your range gun. You probably put a suppressor right on your range gun. This with 9mm with 147 grain ammo would be subsonic. You get an inexpensive suppressor. It threads right on. You got your $200 tax stamp. You can put it on other things, but boom, it's for this. Now you have 9mm pistol. Now it has a 9mm carbine that's also threaded. Not bad. And they said they're going to start doing this. Of course, they have the 10mm already out. This threaded, the 10mm carbine. Mm-hmm. They will start doing the threaded barrel optics ready thing on the other handguns probably next year or the year after. Who knows? But it's in the pipeline. So now you can have 45 subsonic threaded barrel optic ready. That could be in the close. Hey, by the time all your paperwork is done, you can get it. It'll probably be out. Just saying. It's more options from a company that people said never did anything, and you still sell these ugly 10-round single stacks. Now they're doing something else, and they've moved into the double stack arena, which means, it'll come with a 10, because, again, High Point wanted to be 50-state legal during the magazine assault weapons ban, so that's why all theirs were 10 or below in capacity. Now they have come up with 10-round double stack magazines, which means they will also sell magazines that maybe have 15 rounds or even 20. Who knows where they'll stop, because they also have those red ball mags that hold 20 and are single stack. They're making some changes. I think it's pretty cool for an American company. Again, it's one of the top 10 firearms producers in the country. And they're still making moves for the budget market.
And they're responding to customer requests, right?
Yep.
I mean, that's really the big thing to me is they identified that they needed the carbine in 10mm, and they could do it at a price point that nobody else could touch. And they're, from what I understand, they are selling the crap out of them.
Oh, yeah. There are a whole lot of people eating crow, waiting on that High Point 10mm to come through.
Yeah. So I wouldn't be surprised if this is the same thing.
My suggestion is you contact High Point. You find out when they're coming out with that 10mm handgun and just keep on them.
If it's something you want to do, I'm not interested in a 10mm High Point pistol, but the 10mm High Point carbine, I think, was brilliant.
Yeah. But if you camping gun, whatever gun, cabin gun, a 10mm is hot, a lot of heat. A lot of heat that you can put out on something that's coming at you.
It's loaded, right? Yeah.
Yeah. That's got fur and claws. All right, guys. That's it. We doubled down on Gear Whore because, again, this is the SHOT Show Hangover Show. Wow. Like Bear Arms Show podcast.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Hey, John, what's up? We're going to be back with whatever the heck it is I do next. What do we do next?
Who cares?
Training concepts. We'll talk about
training stuff. Concepts for those of you who actually listen.
Be right back. Welcome back to episode 48, SHOT Show Hangover. We're going into training concepts. Training concepts are something that really annoys me because it's when people repeat something they heard but don't understand what was really meant. One of the things is, most self-defense shootings happen in the dark. You've heard that one too, right, Sean?
Yes, we've talked about why it's not technically correct.
Well, yeah, and if you haven't heard, why it's not technically correct is because FBI says that most self-defense shootings happen during the hours of darkness, which does not mean they happen in the dark. They can happen in a parking garage. It's not dark in the parking garage. It's just night outside. And one of the justifications that they use for some of the gear that you wear is because all this stuff happens at night. And one of the things that annoy me is the night sights thing. Oh, you need night sights. How do you operate without night sights? How do you see your sights at night? How are you going to shoot someone at night if you can't see your sights? I'm like, hey, buddy, if I can't see my sights, I can't see who I'm shooting at. I mean, I do need to identify my target too, don't I? So if it's so dark I can't see the pistol in front of my face, am I gonna see the thing I'm shooting at?
Bruh, do you even operate?
Yeah. So
that's what your nods are for.
Oh yeah, I love those guys.
Stop being poor.
Stop so being poor.
Pressure height night sights on your pistol that have to be NVG compatible.
Yeah. sometimes, man, people don't listen to everything. I often find it's someone. It's like night sights. You need night sights. Well, why do what? Stop. What? How about I need light? That would help a lot. Either a standalone flashlight, a weapons mounted light, or why not both? That would help. Night sights. I haven't found the use for them yet. Now, I've taken classes. We've taken low light classes. We've hosted low light classes. We've taken low light carbine. Mm-hmm. I've done low light freaking self defense. And again, no, haven't needed them. Not saying they're not necessary. I just haven't gotten to the point where I found I've needed them. If you want to get them, get them. But what I'm seeing is a lot of people getting things without understanding how stuff works, and then they don't try them out. And some of the night sights need to be charged. You need to shine a flashlight or some source of light on them before they activate. I'm like, well, great. How does that work? Like,
if I have a flashlight to charge my night sights, why don't I shine my flashlight on the bad guy?
Just didn't get it. And maybe
hold I'm on, not... Mr. Unlawful Home Entry Man. I need a moment. Stand fast. I am charging my night sight, sir. Just be a moment.
Just a minute.
Hold on. The manual says at least 60 seconds of direct light. Please be patient. Thank you.
Now, again, it might be my ignorance talking, but I'm like, again, I haven't used them in the training I've had.
I did.
Okay.
Right. I've got that Glock 22. I put Glock brand factory, whatever you want to call them, night sights on it. It's literally the only upgrade I did to that gun.
Mm-hmm.
They're there. I don't really think about it much. But since 99% of the shooting I do is in a situation where those night sights are really just acting as three dot sights, I don't feel it makes a tremendous difference.
I love the fact that you and I pretty much have a contest on who can keep their stock Glock the stockest. It's like,
well, you know, I couldn't let that go. I had to put a sight on yours. I was like, no, I changed the sights on mine. He's changed the sights on his. I'm not having this.
You're like, oh, no, you have a high vis front sight on yours. All right, then I'll just take
it. You're like, I didn't want that. I was like, you're doing it whether you like it or not.
Yeah, that was not voluntary, by the way. and my
no,
FFL,
that's not true. That's not
my
true.
FFL, yeah. Of course, knows me. And he goes, Tony's a cheap bastard, but he shoots a lot. So I'll just reverse his stock Glock sight with the little white ring, and I'll just reverse it and put it in backwards so the black side is facing him. I'm like, hey, thanks, Bob. That worked out really well. Anybody else would be like, the sight's on backwards. I can't use that. I'm like, hey, that's perfect. That saved me from using a Sharpie.
Shanks.
Mm-hmm. El Cheapo. But the reason I brought it up, one, is to get that information out there, because I don't think it's been said enough that people get that wrong and don't understand why they get it wrong. We have to learn the why behind some of the stuff we do. You don't just do it because you hear it, because it could be heard or misinterpreted, whatever, and then you have bad information. If you're going to take this training thing seriously, it's important not to just do the drills, not to just do what they say, but understand the why behind why you're doing it. Why are you holding the flashlight this way and not that way? Why do you recommend it this way? Why don't you try multiple ways of doing it? And I'm just talking about the flashlight only because we're thinking about the low light class or low light classes that we've held, and when you talk about the different ways of holding your lights. Well, when we teach or when we host a class with Mike Wolford, he explains the why. Why would you use this method? Why would you use this method? How would you use this? It's important as instructors that you explain the why to your student so they can make choices of their own, or wise choices, and they can explain it. Because when you're a student of this, when you take classes, more than likely that makes you the gun guy among your gun friends, because most gun owners don't take classes. So if you're going to talk to your friends or your circle, you might be the gun guru in that circle and you've only taken one or two classes, but at least understand the why behind what you're telling them. I think that's really important if we're going to spread good knowledge in the community. What do you think about that?
Okay, so I, you know, and this is something I wanted to say earlier, and I went, let me just go grab this gun and confirm it before I say it. Really, I think the best application for these night sights is not in no light, but in low light. When it's dim, you can still see the gun, you can still see your target, but it's dark enough where you're going, I'm having a little bit of trouble picking up those sights. That's the only time where I think night sights are actually appropriate.
Okay.
It gives you just a little bit of help there. So it's not even like, well, I can't see my sights at all. No, it's just a little bit easier. And to that extent, it may be almost more of a vision issue than a lighting issue. Kind of like you found, was it you I was talking to, that by changing the color of the front sight, it was easier for you to pick up?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Again, I have no problem learning something new, but I'm just saying.
Same kind of thing.
It was a question to me.
Yeah, it's, but again, it's not the application of, okay, it's completely dark in my house. Pitch black, I can't see anything, but I can see these three dots floating around out there. So that's good enough for me to shoot in this direction where a home intruder may or may not be. If you can't identify your target, you shouldn't be shooting it, right?
Mm-hmm.
But maybe you can identify your target, but it's just dark enough that you're having a hard time picking up your sights. Happens a little bit quicker with those dots on there and the fact that they have a little bit of a glow to them. Even that, they're not super bright, but you can find them, right? And since you and I are you know, near the same age and grew up in an era where three dot sights and Novak sights were kind of a thing.
Uh-huh.
That was part of what I learned with shooting handgun. So uh-huh. That's a point of familiarity for me. So that was an improvement over the U, whatever they call the sight on the Glock.
Oh, sucky. Sucky. Dude, I don't understand.
The U suck. Sight. Yeah. Yeah.
But again, my U sight is just reversed. It's just turned around, and right. It works fine with. But okay, cool. I'm glad, because I'm like, I don't get this whole thing. But that's what I really wanted to talk about in training concepts today. Learn the why behind stuff so you can explain it. And really, if that helped explain it to me, okay, lower light, not darkness, but lower light, and mm-hmm. It allows it easy to see, just like my high vis front sight.
Dim. Makes sense now. Dusk, those are appropriate times to use night sights, not dark or pitch black or without light.
Because, man, that's how a bunch of people say it, isn't it?
Yeah.
When it's dark out. What? All right, we're going to come back with gun culture. Episode 48, SHOT Show Hangover, Gun Culture. I'm going to talk about some of the podcasts that I listen to just because it's entertaining. Also, it's firearms related. And I want to do this every now and again just to give you some ideas of the shows I listen to and introduce you to maybe shows you haven't heard. So the AR-15 podcast is one I enjoy. It's on the Firearms Radio Network, and it's hosted by JD and Reed, and they talk about the AR-15s in every aspect. They have a lot of guests on from AR-15 manufacturers. They talk about bills a lot. They talk about every possible aspect of AR-15s, and I find it very interesting because you wouldn't think doing a weekly show on ARs would be, but it is. And I've been on the show a few times. It's a lot of fun. Those guys are. Reed said, Reed was in the Marine Corps at the same time I was. So he's like, iron sights, iron sights. You need iron sights. And it's entertaining because JD is, of course, a younger guy and busts his chops all the time about it. But I find
yes, you also need sharp knife to fight Sabretooth.
Hey, don't sleep on a sharp knife. It'll poke you. But yeah, the AR show is fun. Reed is also a big 357 SIG guy. And he built a 357 SIG AR pistol caliber carbine.
All right, that's kind of cool. not a fan. Like, personally, I'm not a fan of the 357 SIG, but I can see why that would be a good idea.
Yeah.
100. Load bottleneck cartridge.
Uh-huh.
You know, rifle length controllability, or even, you know, pistol caliber pistol. Uh-huh. Like AR pistol chambered in 357 SIG. Yeah, that mm-hmm.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
The 125 grain bullet moving out at over 1400 put holes in things. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But another one. Mm-hmm. So it's a fun show.
Hold on, I gotta write this down. AR pistol. Break your face. Get out of my house. Okay, you got it.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah. Civilian Carry Radio is another one I listen to with Baraka James. It's hosted by him. He usually has a panel of two to three other guys or people, and they interview firearms trainers, just a different firearms trainer every week, different disciplines of it. You know, some are tactical guys, some are self-defense guys or girls. And it's interesting because, again, these are people from all over the country. Spencer Keepers, he's on there sometimes as a guest. They have law enforcement trainers sometimes as guest host. So you get experience, a lot of experience in one podcast, talking about training and the different aspects of training. And again, asking questions and giving you the why behind why trainers do certain things. I think it really helps in your growth if you're taking this martial art of firearm self-defense seriously. It really helps if you have a diversity of opinions and just education brought to you. You don't have to learn everything on your own.
Diversity, there's that word again.
Yeah, no, it's a big thing. But diverse opinions and diverse experiences also might help you learn something better or even help you teach something better because you teach from your own experience. You listen to Sean and myself, you listen to other shows, you get nuggets of stuff that you repeat to people. Well, if they don't get the way you're saying it one way, maybe this thing you heard on another show from another trainer will help. And I think that's a great thing about listening to podcasts. And that's one of the reasons I do it. Plus, I'm a gun geek, so it's gun stuff, and I listen to it.
Or might get an idea like, you know, all right, I disagree with you. I'm not a fan of the 357 SIG, but a 357 AR pistol, well, that's a good idea. You get a different approach at something that maybe you didn't like before that you suddenly find value in.
Yeah.
357 AR pistol. Glock magazine, pistol brace. I'm making my list. Go ahead.
Uh-huh. I see that. Now you just got to pick out your color from Timber Creek.
Yep. St. Patrick's Day. I'm telling you, that emerald green is hot.
I can't wait. Yeah. And what pistol brace you're using and everything.
It's going to be Odorworks. I just told you.
Oh,
haven't
yeah,
you paid attention to a word I said?
Now I don't listen to this show. Now the last one is, of course, I have no idea if I repeated this. I tried to go back in my show notes to see. Whatever. Gun for Hire Radio with Anthony Calandro and Sandy.
Yep.
They talk about gun control in New Jersey, gun control throughout the country, current events. They interview people of diverse backgrounds. Their work is 2A advocates. And it's a very, very fun show because Anthony shot the heck out. He's wide open. Sandy is just... He tries to keep him in check, but
tries to rein him in. Yeah, he tries to be the voice of reason. It's very similar in style and feel to the relationship on this show.
Yeah, you mean people that are real friends actually well before they ever cracked a mic, and now they're doing a show together?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a thing.
Uh-huh. It's a great show. It's really worth listening to. They're at episode 300 and something or some kind of like that. But listen all the time. And I really like these shows. So I just wanted to give you some idea of the shows I listen to, what's on those shows. Two of them are on the Firearms Radio Network, Civilian Carry Radio, and the AR-15 podcast. Really liked them. Gun for Hire Radio. Love that. Yep. They have a studio in the Gun for Hire range, a radio studio dedicated to just doing the show there. I think it's great. And I'll probably be on it, hopefully, a couple of times this year. So that's gun culture, just going deeper into gun culture and the stuff I listen to. I used to watch some shows on, but hey, that cable TV got expensive and the Pursuit Network, it had to go.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, sorry. And truthfully, they only had one good night on there anyway, which is Wednesday night at the range, hosted by Midway USA. And it was like three shows. Other than that, it just had the hunting shows that would get on my nerves because these people would whisper all the time and take all day to stalk something. and it was just the worst. Hold on. Check it. We're going to go over here and creep behind this tree. And then see what we see on the other side of the tree. All right, there's nothing on this side of the tree. I'm like, oh my.
How Tony, wait. There's another side of the tree. Let's try looking around the other side of the tree.
You see that?
Did you see that? It's a rock. Yup, it's a rock. I can see it.
Yeah.
Over. We'll be back after the commercial break for another 45 minutes of us whispering around a tree.
There it is.
And it's so freaking far away, you can't even see it on the screen.
Mm-hmm.
Like they're pointing the camera at it. You can't see it. Not at all. Nope. I don't know if they're hunting turkey or like springbok or white-tailed deer or Tyrannosaurus rex. I have no idea.
I am not a hunter. I'm a gun guy. They won't tell you what gun they're using. They won't tell you anything about the firearm.
Yeah.
Got it. And then they shoot it and they like high five and yell and cry and hug each other.
Right.
I'm like, what?
They have that deep emotional moment.
Yeah, that deep moment.
Yeah.
I'm like, whatever.
Look, I gave up on cable because April and I watched like two shows that were on cable. And we did the math, and we were paying like $35 an episode to watch the two shows that we enjoyed. And I went, "Yeah, I need that money for guns."
Yeah, I'm starting to feel the same way. It's like, wait a minute, I watched like three shows. It's like the cable bill is really expensive. I can watch those three shows on my phone.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
What am I doing? All right, guys, we'll be back with shout-outs.
I don't know if you will, but I obviously will.
You won't stop talking over my intro. Episode 48, SHOT Show Hangover. We're in the shout-outs and announcements.
Hey, Sean, what are we going to do? We're in a shout-out. Because we're shot out. You know, this job doesn't pay real well, but I'm happy because I get to drink. So, hello?
Yeah, I know. I'm sitting here, made a mistake. My wife wanted mixers so she can drink, and I bought her grapefruit juice. Hey, take don't
something that tastes awful and mix it with something awfuler.
Yeah. Next time you tell me exactly, because I got you regular grapefruit juice, that stuff to turn your face inside out. How do I know she not didn't want that? I don't know. I don't make drinks. Anyway, hey Sean, go ahead. We introduce the
okay
Patreon.
So you've got your Patreon prizes all lined up, right? The limited edition, special edition, limited select, hand limited. 2A4E series knives that were donated by Car Arms as a Spyderco limited edition with the 2A4E logo laser engraved and a serial number from NJ Concealment Furniture. So this is a limited production, limited edition, special edition, limited edition. We took the number of Patreon supporters currently making donations on a monthly basis, put the number into a randomizer. The randomizer selected a number. We took the number that corresponds to the winner, and the winner is...
Oh, my gosh. Taking too long. Ray DeJour, you won. Ray DeJour. Ray of the day. Ray actually won this month's knife. So we'll either mail it to him or... He can contact us. I guess I should have contacted him before we did it just to see if he wanted it mailed to him or not, but it's not that professionally run. So you're going to get it. You're going to also have a letter handwritten thanking you for all that you do in helping us make this show come to you weekly.
Oh, ho, ho, ho. That's like an M. Night Shyamalan twist. Tony Simon thanking you for all you do.
It's a twist. You didn't see it coming. So that's what I'm doing. And I really appreciate it, Ray. And all you guys that donate.
I say
yes.
Don't call him. Don't tell him he won. Wait until he listens.
Okay.
If
all right.
If he wants it, he'll let you know.
Yeah, that's the way we're doing it. Yeah, if you want it,
if
you call me.
To be listening to the podcast and know you won
mm-hmm.
it. If you don't
yeah.
get it, you don't get it.
Yeah.
That knife is cool.
That's funny. Yeah, you call me if you want. The 1 week, you know, Ray doesn't get it.
Right.
But here's the funny part.
You've been giving me money all this time to support what I do. And now to get your prize, you got to chase me down.
Uh-huh. That just sounds funny, but yeah, it ain't happening. Sure. excuse me. Also, next week, we will be giving away the Winter Warrior patch.
What?
From Patriot Patch Company. Oh, I'm not giving away mine. You're giving away yours, Sean. But
I didn't get one. And if you think you're getting April's, you're going to have to fight her for it.
It's the Winter Warrior Winter Warfare patch. It comes with a Winter Warfare sticker, the Winter Warfare patch, and the artist renditioning of it when he drew it out, Ryan Cross. So it's pretty cool. And this goes out
January patch of the month, the Patriot patch of the month club.
And if you want to join the patch of the month club, it's $15,
mm-hmm.
right? $15 a month yep. to patch the month. So for being a $5 or above Patriot, your name goes into the list. I mean, it's not even a raffle. It's just I'm picking one of you guys to win this because you donate to us. So I think that's just cool. I'm not a patch guy, but you guys are, and I hope good luck to anyone who wins. All right, so we're going into shout outs, and I think I'm going to combine this one just because of what's going on at this time. The NRA ballots are out.
Mm-hmm.
In your hot little hands. And so this week's shout out is going to Anthony Calandro and Adam Kraut. These two guys are pretty much outsiders as far as the NRA is concerned. And I would really like to see them on the board of directors of the NRA because they believe in that change. Anthony and Adam are actual friends of mine. They believe in the diversity in the firearms community. They believe in getting rid of some of these laws. They believe that the NRA should be leading the fight, not making deals. And they know the NRA needs to change. A lot of us out here are dissatisfied with the direction the NRA is going in and the things they've been doing lately. Well, the only way you can make it change is to change it. Not being in the NRA, they don't care what you feel or think.
Yeah, if you're cutting up your NRA membership and not giving them money anymore and doing all that stuff, that's fine. That's your choice. But understand, if that's what you do, they no longer care any more about your opinion than they do the opinion of a member of Moms Demand Action.
Exactly.
So you're not a voting member. You don't get a say. Voting is how you get a say in what goes on with NRA.
Wayne LaPierre doesn't care what you feel if you're not a member. So Anthony Colangelo, Adam Kraut, you don't have to put 20-something names down on the vote. Matter of fact, it's more effective if you don't just circle 20-something names. These are people that actually put in work. These are people that do work. Anthony hosts lots of things, donates lots of Second Amendment groups. Anthony holds it down. Adam, of course, is the lawyer that's suing these townships and taking these people to court and fighting
him and Joshua Prince.
Him and Josh Prince, they're actually fighting these laws themselves. That's their day job. Another day job Adam has is working in the gun shop. Adam has NFA items. Adam wants to get rid of the NFA. He thinks it's stupid. Just stand up, guys, that believe in your Second Amendment right. Wholly think all gun laws are infringements. These are the guys we need on the NRA board. We need pit bulls. We need diehards. We need fanatics for our Second Amendment rights. And these are what these two guys are. This is not a compromise. These dudes are ready to fight. So that's what this week's shout out. Anthony Colangelo, Adam Kraut for NRA director. Something else I'd like to say, and I'd like to give a shout out to Cheryl Todd.
Nice.
And her husband. And our husband over at Arizona AZ Firearms and Gun Freedom Radio. I was on the show last year, and they sent me their new calendar, their 2019 calendar. I think it's pretty cool. What the heck? So they sent that to me, and I thought it was awesome. I also got my training certificate, for taking the Intuitive Defensive Shooting course from ICE training. Like, they came a day apart in the mail. I'm like, ooh, look at me, I'm getting mail that I don't have to just directly throw in the garbage.
Or write a check and send back.
Write a check. What the heck?
Bills.
Anyway.
Bills.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Return the sender. Address unknown.
I can't get it.
Sometimes my money is funny. Sometimes it's dead. Sometimes it ain't. Right now it ain't. Click. That was actually a phone call my friend Dave got one day. It was freaking hilarious. He was doing phone tree for the PBA and called a black barbershop. Hi, would you like to donate to the PBA? What? The who? The policeman, Beloved Associate. My money is funny. Sometimes it's there, and sometimes it ain't. And right now, it ain't. Click.
Nice.
Call a barbershop in the hood asking for money for the PBA. So, let me see. Shout outs. This. What we doing next? I got a tentative date for the 2A4E diversity shoot, Gun for Hire Range, February 21st. Because we're not doing it on Valentine's Day, which is February 14th.
Thank you. So that's the following Thursday.
Yeah, this is the following Thursday after Valentine's Day.
Excellent.
The Thursday before that, we're going to be up in. It started in Black History Month. It will continue to start Black History Month at Gun for Hire Range. So February 21st, look at that. Tickets will be up soon. And that's what I wanted to let you guys know. Really appreciate you guys waiting. I've been getting some phone calls and some emails going, hey, Tone, when's the next one? Well, next one is February 21st. If that date changes, I'll let you know immediately. Also, if you want to support us and the things we do, you can donate to our GoFundMe, which is 2A4E. You can type that in the search. The second is for everyone. It'll pop right up. You can donate to that. You can also donate to our Patreon. You can become a patron on Patreon, $5 and above. $5 and above will get you stickers and stuff like that. And of course, as you found out, Ray DeJure won a really nice knife. If you're $10 and above, you can do stuff that'll have you talking to an FFL. And also, one of the next things we have going on, when we get 25 people, 25 patrons, is give away the Wheel of Freedom.
Oh.
Which, yeah, that Wheel of Freedom is still sitting here, still in the package. I haven't even taken it out because I'd want to keep it.
Mm.
And it's still wrapped up and ready for you guys. So when we get 25 people, I think it's $5 and above, donating to Patreon, you can win this thing. It has a lot of different firearms manufacturers' logos on it and names on it, including our 2A4E logo, Black Bag Resources logo, New Jersey Concealment Furnishers logo. And it just looks really cool. You cannot buy these. These things are given away by Dan to causes that he really believes in. He makes each one of these special. Every one of them is unique. And it's just an awesome piece to hang on your wall. So, want to get in on it? Got to become a patron. So, those are that. You can purchase your shirts at 1022clothing.us. We have the shirts available there. Pick those up. Rally season's about to start. Man, pick up your blue rally shirt so you can all look cool rocking that same shirt. Just like mom to man, rock those red shirts, you know, commie colors. And you can rock Freedom Royal Blue. I'm just saying. That helps us. Actually, rally shirts don't help us at all. I don't get a dime for that, but I just want you to be able to buy you and your crew some shirts. And if you can do it for $10 a piece, it has our logo on the front. Underneath it says gun control equals racism.
Do you have a regular 2A4E t-shirt that maybe you make a couple of bucks on, Tony?
Yeah, we have the promotion 2A4E t-shirts. They come in black or white. And yes, we make a little bit of money on that. And really, it's really appreciated. So if you guys want to pick some of those up, I'd love it. I'd love it, love it, love it.
So you've got options. You can donate, right, and just give Tony money. Or you can become a patron and maybe win something. Or you can go make a purchase, and some of the money from that will go towards the 2A4E diversity shoots and all that good stuff. Is there any other way they can support you, Tony?
They can definitely support me by going to blackbagresources.com, making a purchase in your store using coupon code 2A4E, and whatever they buy will be delivered to the diversity shoot by you, and we can give that away to a new shooter or whoever comes in the door. Boom. Yep, so that's how you can support us in the 2A4E podcast and the diversity shoot and the work we do. Sean, you got anything you want to put out there, buddy?
Yeah, there's a couple of coupon codes floating around that if you're on Facebook, Instagram, or if you're one of the really deep in people that's in the Black Bag Resources Inner Circle group on Facebook, you can find those coupon codes. There's also, for those of you who want to become members of the NRA, if you go to blackbagresources.com, there's a banner at the top of the page. Join from there. That would be appreciated so I can try and hit my recruiting numbers. And I think that's it for now.
All right. We are going to be at the Great American Outdoor Show coming up in February, the beginning of February. I think it's from the 2nd to the 10th or 2nd to the 9th, something like that.
Yeah, you and I are kind of on different schedules a little bit. Are we doing Monday?
I don't know. I have to find out. It's next Monday anyway, right?
Right.
Yeah, so we'll have to do something about that. We're also going to do our remote, right? We're going to do the remote.
That's the plan for the next episode is going to be the remote from the new location, yeah.
Yep, we're going to do a remote location show. Should be interesting. Hope you guys enjoy it. And then, of course, we're going to be at NRA in Indianapolis. We're rolling deep. We're rolling with a crew, mad deep. That's going to be an NRA. Have you decided you're going to go to the Kevin Dixie training yet or not?
I haven't been able to find any information on it, so I need you to drop that
okay.
in my in my lap for me. Basically, I need you to spoon feed me the information because I'm an idiot. Yep. And then I can run it past the boss here. The director of scheduling can either approve or deny my request.
So that's what we're doing. We're going to have a busy, busy, busy year this year. All right, Sean. Hey, listen, thanks for everybody for listening to the show. Really appreciate it. Hey, Sean, take us out of here, man.
Hope you guys enjoyed this. Bye, Felicia.
Hope you guys enjoyed this.